again, everybody, and welcome to episode 44 in honor of the World Series, the Henry Aaron episode. As always, he's John and I'm Mark. Today, we are joined by former Hall of Famer and current coach of the perennial power ACHA Lindenwood Lions, Rick Zombo. Rick, thanks for jumping on and welcome to Angles and Attitudes.
Hey, Rick.
I appreciate the invite, Mark. John, nice to see you. I think you should talk about the Hall of Fame. That's the Illinois Ice Hockey Hall of Fame.
Yes.
It's not the NHL Hall of Fame.
Hey, so let's make that clear. There's nothing wrong with that. I'm in there with you.
Hey,
Wolf. Yeah, it's quite an honor for that. I'll tell you what. I'm waiting for the Missouri, but I haven't got the invite yet.
Okay.
Well, 66.7% of the guys on this podcast right now are members of the Illinois Hockey Hall of Fame. So I'll step aside in honor and raise a glass in honor of you guys then.
I appreciate it, Mark. No, I'll tell you what, you know, it's funny when you look back to, and my dad never played, but he was a manager and a supporter as a parent and did what he can. I know we used to have the full team's equipment in the garage and sorting it out. And that's when scheduling was done on rotary phones and a notepad. And
right.
It's hilarious how times have changed. But back then, you didn't know any different. I mean, that's just what you've right. done. And we'd go on road trips. And there are many times where, you know, you never thought of a Marriott or a Sheraton. We'd stay at YMCA just to get, you know, more games in. And right. it was unbelievable where you don't tire kids out. And everybody is just loves the ice rink Those were wonderful days.
For sure.
It is a lot different, and you know it from a lot of different perspectives, from the NHL to what you're doing now, as far as the game has changed, the structure of the tournaments, what hotel you have to stay at, just that you were talking about, you know, you've got to sacrifice costs in order to be able to do that. Being in certain leagues, being, you know, required to go to two or three travel tournaments, to Dallas, to Minnesota, to Colorado or whatever, and sometimes losing what it's all about and getting the kids to enjoy the game and grow as human beings and end up being pretty good adult and productive members of society, right?
Yeah, you're 100% correct. How I coach is I use a sport where there's passion and attention amongst the players, and I teach life skills out of it. You can't go wrong with that. You know, this game has adversities on every shift and also in practice. And it's there's such a not only the financial commitment, but also parental time and family commitment that you better get something out of making strong young men out of a hockey player.
Rick, when does it start for you as the hockey player? How far back can you take us?
Well, John, I played all sports. I was good at all sports. You know what we did? We were fortunate that we had a park about 60 yards down the road from my dad, and we lived really close to the park. So everybody would hang out on the front step, wait until either I finished my piano lessons or my brother would finish his drum lessons. And whatever major league sport was going on, that was a sport that we would play down the park. All the neighborhoods were there. The winner stayed on the field. And our only rule was when the streetlights go on, you go off,
right?
Or head home, not go off.
Yeah.
But it's when I got to be 13, 14, the aspirations of being better, playing against better competition, the travel so much, playing open. Back then, it's called open hockey. The expense of doing that made it extremely inconvenient. I know we used to, and it's funny as adults, we look back, but we used to have stamp nights. And all we were doing was licking and sticking and filling up stamps. You know, I had no idea the food stamps, but it's amazing what parents do for your children and provide opportunities. But I ended up moving away. I moved to Toronto when I was 16 years old. I didn't have any guidance. There was no attorneys or advisors back then. It was just hockey talk amongst dads in the rinks, and this is the place to go, or these are the people to see. And, you know, I moved away and I went from, you know, a Chicago public school to a Catholic school, which was almost a boarding school. And it was amazing when you read Macbeth, there's actually meanings in the words, or, you know, the catcher in the rye. This was some pretty heavy stuff that I was always a good student, but I didn't recognize there's a lot more to the learning process than just the subject material. So I grew up really fast at 16 years old, living on my own.
Can imagine.
I'm sure you see that a lot. And again, there's so many similarities. You know, you were talking about, I can remember, and, you know, John's son and my son, my son's 26. And I told him once we couldn't afford to go to a travel tournament. My dad was a Chicago public school teacher. And you just, you know, you didn't have the money, like you were talking about licking stamps or doing whatever. You had to sit one out if you wanted to play the other X number of games for the Franklin Park Jets or in that regard. And kids these days don't see necessarily always and appreciate that. And I'm sure you have to break some guys of that habit where you're at Lindenwood to go, hey guys, this is a privilege to play this game at this level, and you have to continue to respect it and everything that it stands for.
You're 100% right. When I went to school at the University of North Dakota, passing a tradition down was very important inside the dressing room. The alumni returning to make certain that not only they overlooked, but also assisted was extremely important. When you have a winning tradition, it's all from inside the dressing room, and the coach is pretty much along for the ride. They're there to recruit and recruit the right players that not only they want to coach, but would also represent the university and the hockey program as it was left the year before. I take those same things as a coach at Lindenwood University. Recruiting to me for all college sports is probably 70% of the battle to have a successful program. It's not like juniors or pros where you trade and peddle players as assets. It's a nurturing and a bonding situation where realistically sport to me at the college age group is third. And that's beyond having a great education and a lovely social life. The sport is third in those responsibilities. Knowing darn well that my position is all result oriented and it's all about wins and losses, which retain my job. So it's a balancing act on a daily basis. It's managing people, the X's and O's and the awareness and experience through me being a player and also being a coach for an awful lot of years means nothing to athletes nowadays. It's all about now and the present. And so it communication, and I learn every year. It's about communication. It's just not bossing orders and putting a substantial amount of time into your homework in preparation. It's also listening, and it's just not the words, it's the observation of body language and the feel, and it's all about building trust. So it's consuming in itself, but it keeps me challenged.
But this is great that you took what you were doing here in North Dakota to this where we are now in the life, meaning there's so many changes. But again, people just think, oh, there's Zombo. He's just walking up and down the bench. There's so much that parents and the students don't know of what you just said.
Oh, everybody knows Walter Payton's yardage records, but they didn't see what Walter was doing in the summer. They didn't see what Walter before practices. People don't recognize that you don't get good just because of God-given talent. There's a lot of time and effort involved in it, and nobody casts a magic wand when it comes to success. When you recognize, at least in coaching, that there's never a retirement plan, you never get comfortable on your zip code. There's always somebody that's waiting for your fail, and waiting for your fail is more of a business term in sport. At least the levels that I've played at, you earn your ice time, you earn your position, and if somebody's better than you, you take it with a grain of salt and you work harder and you improve and make certain it doesn't happen again. So that's pretty much the way that I coach. Practice time for me is like a calendar year where it's academia. Monday to Thursday is my prime time. The retention and application is like taking a test on the Friday, Saturday games. So it's not so much putting restrictions on players, but making certain that they're learning from Monday to Thursday to provide the experience of not only antagonist views. Sometimes it's only me as a coach, but it's also a competition amongst your teammates. The game should be easy for them. But every day is a challenge for players. Every day is a challenge for me. And keeps me young and spry and active. And I like to get ahead of the questions before they get asked.
There you go. So that first, those first few weeks of the season, where a lot of your guys that come on, whether they come out of junior or that, were always the best guy on their team. Talk a little bit about how you handle that first time the kid has that aha moment and he looks around and there's 25 other guys who are as good or better than him. And now he's got to go, wait a second, this is not on talent alone anymore.
Yeah. And they don't realize it. It's a tough inoculation period. When I say recruiting, we spend a considerable amount of hours watching film, networking, talking to people. Our recruiting, we know exactly what my team's identity is. We recruit inside of our identity. I ask on a personal basis really, really hard questions. And it is not so much the answers as it's the body language. If I got them rocking on their heels, they're really not for me. It is a knowing that I am going to be extremely honest with them. A lot of these better players have not heard that before. And it's also understanding that we're building a team. So there's an awful lot of sports cliches that are being used out there and thrown around. But you just don't put a C or an A on somebody and say, you're a captain. You actually got to lead from the front and teach leadership quality. So, like, to be honest with you, the X's and O's are secondary. It's growing up to be strong men more than anything else. And it goes from top to bottom. Family comes first. They have issues with girlfriends, issues at home, grandparents that are passing. That comes first. And we're all there for a shoulder, not only coaching staff, but also the players. The administration is behind them. And it's like missing a practice. As long as it's not overused, they have projects at school, they have tests. There's an awful lot of stress amongst student athletes nowadays. Student athletes is a term that's been around for a long time. I don't think the workload has been accelerated compared to when I was there. But growing up, we learned coping skills. We learned on a daily basis how to handle adversity and how to carry our own lunchbox. Nowadays, it's a little bit different. And then when you're talking about players, high-end players that we have committed that come to play at Lindenwood, now they have to conform to a team, understand that there's both ends of the rink. Smart enough to know to score goals, you have to cheat, but you can't offend the system. So when I say yes, it's a selfish game. We have these conversations of how to play selfish, how to be selfish, and there's a time and place for it. I like to smile. I want the players to smile. I want them to have fun. The glass at the rink is not to keep fans away from the players. It's to keep your outside crap away from the hockey. And it's when they learn that and learn to relax, that becomes our home. So our dressing room and our rink becomes our home. To have players show up 3 hours before practice is wonderful, because there's never enough hours to talk hockey, to know what it's all about, how's your daily life going, and just to let them know that I truly care about them as an individual instead of a player that sits behind me and I just see their nameplate and number.
Do you see the players still to this day, Rick, that's going through the motions? You can still see it as we move forward with coaching and now all the advancements. The guy that's working hard, you can see it, and the guy that's just going through the motions. It seems like you can pick this up.
Yeah, it's a piece of cake. When you're around hockey people, you'll know within 2-3 minutes if they're full of shit. Like, you know that right off the bat. If they can't talk the game, hockey people understand it. When you're talking about going through the motion, working hard nowadays – excuse me, 1 second. I got dogs that want my attention.
No worries. No worries. Family comes first, Rick.
It's like family first. You know, it's like blocking shots. Everybody knows a shot lane. So when you're playing defensive structure, everybody knows. But if you take a half stride out and say, ooh, shit, you know, it's like Ole, like a matador, like they know, right? Selling out is not that difficult to do. You've got to take one step in a shot lane, and the further away you are, the more it hurts. So I try to teach you got to get closer, and your first step is not to, to close in on a gap, it's to get into shot lanes. It's no different than making passes. You know, making passes, all these players have the ability to make the pass. Going tape is real simple for the caliber of players that I have. But they've got to understand a good pass means you're taking into consideration their next play. So it's a timing of not only when you deliver it, but the pace you put on it. You got to give them an opportunity. You know, it's like a blindside hit, right? Whose fault is it? You know, Doug Plank or Fensick coming over the top, you know, with the Bears? Or is it the passer that sets a guy up for a sucker punch? You know, it's having that consideration. And like, I'm not a yeller and a motivator. I didn't know what they were saying, but they're saying mean mug. Coach was giving you a mean mug. And, you know, they say it so fast. And I didn't know that slang, but to yell and criticize and point out mistakes, all players know where the mistakes are. Having a conversation as far as the little details that are necessary. Why is it important to work on the backhand of your stick, making backhand passes? It's amazing how many players get to my level that were either not allowed to, or the curves are way too big where it's impossible to, right? It makes games very, very easy once you break things down into as simplest forms of fundamental hockey. And that's all we do. I mean, it's anybody can skate 200 miles an hour. Everybody can sweat and say, ooh, wow, look at that. But for me, it's the details of the game, talking the game, letting them know what I'm watching. So when they come and I have a mean mug or they haven't played for 8 minutes, just because you scored 2 goals, mm-hmm. we'll have a discussion as far as why you sat for 8 minutes. Somebody is scoring goals, I want them out there as much as possible. However, there's alterations that are necessary against better competitions, more stringent defense, and also for maturity and growth in our program to win the big game. And that's what Linda Winter Hockey is all about. It's to win a national title. It's the last game on our schedule, but it's tough to get there. You got to win 4 straight and the stars have to be in line. But it's all about the preparation.
The players you watch, you scout, the coaching that leads these players to you, you know, that's a part that I'm sure you kind of scratch your head and go, how do we improve the coaching so that those guys are not thinking about being the Scotty Bowman of House League or being the Scotty Bowman of Central States Development League, but really develop a kid. And don't take a 12-year-old or an 11-year-old, put him on defense on his backhand and then yell at him because he can't make a breakout pass because he's coming up on his off wing. And then you scream at him when he goes back to the bench. And it's like, well, coach, you got to explain to him, then work in practice on the backhand. But then mom and dad pay $6,000 and don't want to watch that at practice. That's a tough balance, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a lot. If you're a good baseball coach, you'll be a good basketball coach. You'll be a good hockey coach. You need the communication and understanding, not only the subject matter, but also how to deliver it to your pupils. So what I always do, and as a matter of fact, my oldest boy is coaching now. You got to coach learn to play. You got to coach the B-level players, okay? Anybody can coach AAA. As far as knowledge, the internet has all knowledge in the world. That's the science of the game. The art of the game is the communication and how to manipulate individuals to receive some type of challenge or uncomfortability into their normal pattern. So a lot of the and volunteerism doesn't mean that you're entitled, right? So when you're talking about youth coaches, you give them an awful lot of credit to volunteer their time, but there's way more work that's done away from the rink than there is on the rink. It's always learning more. First, you got to learn the players. And once you learn the players, then once you know the subject matter, there's different angles of presentation or different words that you have to be able to use because your players pick up messages differently, right? Mm-hmm. Some see in pictures, some can do verbal, some 3 times. Sometimes you got to walk them through it. Once you understand that and not put them all into the same mold or mixing bowl, it'll make things a lot more suitable. You know, I see youth hockey teams doing routes on a breakout. Well, they can't make a pass. If you can make a 10-foot pass, why are there routes? Why do you got to learn routes when you're talking about PK? You know, I mean, I could go on and on, but if you're a good communicator and really take the benefits and the welfare for progression more important than the games, that's what it's all about, because it is expensive. And everybody wants immediate dividends in their investment, and everybody wants a short-term fix. So having a good coach is extremely valuable for me recruiting and even advising young players. I say, follow the coach. You have to follow the coach. You know, when you come to my level, I shouldn't be teaching the 100 level of ice hockey or 200 level of ice hockey. If you have a good coach, it makes things a lot easier for me, and also has ingrained the earn your ice time motto and no entitlement. So, you know, it's only one team had the Mario Lemieux stick budget, and it's not me. You know, I've got a bunch of ditch diggers that I've got to blend together that have a Navy SEAL mentality and a huge heart and compassion for their teammates. And that homework was done by watching a lot of film, but also making phone calls, not necessarily to their head coach, but also the opponents. When the name came, you know, I didn't need justification if anybody else was on them. But you got to put together a pretty complete book. And now at my level, we're building books on 15-year-olds, if you can believe that. Mm-hmm. Still a little young for me to watch, but you're always writing down notes and you're always logging it. And you just watch the maturity level and the growth of them to see if it's right. But we put a lot of time into recruiting.
Rick, I don't want to lose Mark. If you just give me just a quick here. Our viewing audience, of course, a lot of it is a hockey audience, but I know a lot of people, I was telling a lot of people that you were going to be coming on the show. Can you take us back when you were drafted by the Red Wings, you know, from Adirondack? Yeah. Did you know at that level that, okay, I'm going to get to this level? What was going through your mind in those early 80s? That was a special time for me because it was guys like you, Chelios, yourself. Those were guys Mark and I's age. Take us through that, just, you know, the mindset.
Yeah, no, I appreciate it. So, in high school, I was living in Austin, Minnesota. There was a USHL team. I played for the all-star team, the Spangler Cup. That time, 35 of the players got some type of scholarship to Division I. I had my choice of any school to go to. So my recruiting trips, you're only allowed to go to four. I had the grades to go to Harvard. So I went to RPI, which is Rensselaer Polytech. I went to Wisconsin, Minnesota, and also North Dakota. I was living in Minnesota. So those were my four recruiting trips. I was living in Minnesota, and I would have been, I was draft eligible. But for the Gophers, I would have been the first Gopher outside of Minnesota to play for the Gophers. Wisconsin, on my recruiting trip there, it was kind of too big of a city for me and almost too close to home. And at that time, Badger Bob was talking about his son that was playing in the NHL and very little about me. So it came down to RPI, and RPI was an up and growing program just north of Albany, New York. I had the grades to do it, so I wasn't frightened from the grades. They had a really good recruiting year. But the year that I ended up going to North Dakota, all six of us played the NHL. Chelly was on his way on a recruiting trip that year, my year also. And a fellow by the name of Grant Stanbrook came to O'Hare and cut off Chelly on his flight to Grand Forks. And he was the assistant coach of Wisconsin, drove him up in a van to Wisconsin, said, Zombo committed here, and a first round pick by the name of James Patrick to the Rangers committed. Okay. So that was the prelude prior to the draft in June. When I was living in Minnesota, Austin, Minnesota, I had access to, well, at that time, the North Stars had 5 second-round draft picks. So I was on the phone with Lou Nanny and Glenn Sonmore a lot. That was the brass for the Minnesota North Stars. I had tickets. Bloomington from Austin was about an hour and a half, 2 hour drive. Any tickets I wanted to watch the Stars play and to send again with the Gophers. So anyway, I was expecting I was going to be a second round pick to the North Stars. I decided I was going to commit to University of North Dakota, where it was a pro factory. You never spend 4 years there. You go in, learn a pro style game, and you're well groomed to play in the National Hockey League. So I made a decision to go to North Dakota. At that time, you don't sit in front of a laptop and a computer and watch the draft. There's no agents involved. You wait for a phone call. And I say I was the first round pick. Well, I was the first round pick after they broke for lunch. So 8 rounds went by, and I got drafted to Detroit Red Wings. At that time, the general manager was by the name of Jimmy Skinner. I never had any kind of conversation with any scout or anybody. But I got a phone call from Jimmy Skinner and said, congratulations, my name is Jimmy Skinner. And we selected you in the 8th round. I think I was third or fourth pick for the Red Wings. And it wasn't hip, hip, hooray, pop a cork. It's like, okay, I'm going to school. You know, I knew that that's what I wanted to do, was play in the National Hockey League. But my, I was extremely humble, and I knew there are steps on its way, right? So going to North Dakota was foremost to me. Once I got to North Dakota, then I started getting the NHL bug, because a lot of upperclassmen were signing, going. We were the team to beat for the 3 years that I was there. My freshman year, we won a national title at North Dakota. My second year, we lost in the quarterfinals to Wisconsin in overtime on a illegal curve call. My third year, we lost. It wasn't even called the Frozen Four there, but we lost in our semifinal game in double overtime to Bowling Green. And at that point, I was an 8th round draft pick. My grades were good. I went to school as a pre-veterinarian major, but my chemistry labs conflicted with practice schedules, so I went into general business. So the school process took a little bit of a left turn, because I was a runner at the Chicago Board of Trade. So you really don't need an education to be a trader at the board. And as far as being a veterinarian, the passion and love and intelligence was still there at that time. But playing in the National Hockey League, I wasn't going to get any better opportunity than where I was at. And at that national tournament is when a general manager for a fellow by the name of Neil Smith. So he was the assistant general manager underneath Jimmy Devolano, was in attendance at the national tournament. And Roger Christian, Christian Brothers Hockey Sticks, David and Eddie were both North Dakota alumni. So he was kind of like, not an agent, but kind of assisted my father with, how do you talk to, you know, assistant GM? And they had a signing bonus of $25,000. I bought myself a Mustang GT and had an opportunity to go try out. And you know, it's funny, because you can pay 25 G's chasing a broom at Sears, but I was happy as can be, and I had an opportunity. And you just make what you can out of it. You know, 8th round pick, I had no scouts. I had nobody pushing for me and pulling for me. You know, when it's all said and done, there are 3 years in a row that they had my plane ticket already set for the minors, you know, before I even showed up at the NHL camp. And I got lucky, because at that time, Bob Goodnow was a player rep. Bob Goodnow was NHL president for the Alumni Association. Bob Goodnow lived in Dearborn, Michigan. I got to know Bob pretty good. And there was also a new coach by the name of Jacques Demers that had a history of taking ditch diggers and giving them opportunities. So Bob Goodnow said, okay, you got cut from camp. You might not have deserved the cut, but go talk to Jacques and at least introduce yourself where you're at. He goes, for all he knows, it's alphabetical and you're on the bottom of the list. So at least you can put a face with a name. And Jacques was a man of his words. He said, you'd be the best defenseman down there. If we have an injury, you'd be the first call up. And that was the case. I never looked back from then on. I had an opportunity and played in the show. And it was just a humble experience. I appreciate it. Every day I walked to the rink and didn't flash around money. I mean, it was just the joy of competing and being around an elite group of people. We're crazy. I mean, it's a bunch of young kids with a lot of money. And we have a lot of fun, but it's a hard grind. But when you're that passionately connected to teammates and you know, at Detroit that time, that was the bottom of the North Division. You know, 55, 60 points was pretty much where we're at. And what we did was we built from within. I think Jimmy Devlin took a page out of not only the Islanders, but also the Habs. Send your guys to the minors, groom them, teach them what it's like to win. We won the Calder Cup the year before, which is, you know, for the American Hockey League in Adirondack. And then we all got called up. And heck, it was 2 years after that. We lost to Edmonton in the semifinals 2 years in a row. I mean, that's when all those Hall of Famers are young, from Coffey to Gretz to Grant, Glenn Anderson. I mean, it was crazy how good those guys were. But we went to the semis 2 years in a row and lost. But still, I wasn't making any kind of money. I got a call my third year with Detroit. I thought a player was playing a prank on me. It was Mike Ilitch. So the Ilitch family owned not only Little Caesars Pizza, but the Tigers and the Red Wings. And yeah, sure. They say, yeah, Mike. So he goes, yeah, I was reviewing your contract. And he wrote me a check for another $25,000 because I was underpaid and he valued me. And it was the way you get treated in Detroit is really unbelievable. I mean, it's an overused phrase, we're a family, you know. The Pirates of the 70s, you know, lived up to it and started that. And what was that, Sister Sledge? They put the song Sister together, Sledge, you know, yeah. With that. But playing for Detroit in those days was amazing. My only regret was Scotty Bowman called me the year they won the Stanley Cup. I had been bought out of my contract with Boston. And I felt I was good enough and still healthy enough for a one-way ticket. And I didn't want to settle on a two-way ticket. I could have been back in Detroit. But it was Scotty that called. And as it turned out, you know, the better deal didn't come around. And I ended up closing out for LA's farm team in Phoenix. And at that time, my kids were old enough, enjoying school, and I had enough money in the bank to enjoy life. And it was time to go to the glue factory. Even though I was healthy and extremely happy, I didn't want to be that one of those guys just chasing a dream and hanging in there for a paycheck.
Well, that's a lot of your story, and we appreciate you sharing. Is obviously built on the Midwestern roots of being humble and understanding that you have to earn everything you get. And I'm sure that stayed with you, and the Red Wings recognized that, and it paid off in the long run for you. Got to ask, your time in St. Louis, obviously everybody talked about how excited everybody was for St. Louis winning the Stanley Cup. As born and bred Blackhawk fans, you know, we don't trips to the old St. Louis Arena, the Checkered Dome and all of those things. We still can't, whether it's the Cardinals or the, or the Blues. Talk a little bit about your time in St. Louis and how that's evolved with those guys turning out, you know, the Tkachuks and the Browns and all those kids now through the AAA programs, as well as a result of the Blues.
It is, St. Louis is one of those cities where it's in the Midwest, but it's south enough where the pace is slow and also hospitable. Everything is clandestine as far as zip codes and locales, and are you from St. Louis or aren't you from St. Louis? And if you're on the outsider or on the outside, it takes a while to get acclimated or accepted. One of the benefits that we have as players that played for the Blues, the fans really want to get to know the players outside of their program. They want to know who you are as a person more so than a professional athlete in a petting zoo. It makes for a very comfortable way of life. It's actually real easy to play professional hockey for St. Louis because the fans are so warm and welcoming. So Currently, I think there's about 40 players that make our home alumni. We make our home here in St. Louis. Not all of them has retired being a St. Louis Blue, but the way that we've been received and welcomed and the cost of living and the temperatures, very enjoyable. The time offered as far as alumni go, to just not their own children, but anytime in the ice rinks, players always step up. NHL alumni step up. We're not used to, I don't care what team you play for, used to paying retail, but when it comes to providing time as a trade-off, I don't know of anybody that says no when it comes to offering assistance to young children. And then when you're in the sport that they've been so fortunate to play and make a living at, they jump at the opportunity to share their time and knowledge. So we've been really lucky. The alumni spend a considerable amount of time in the ice rinks, assisting not only their children, but others. And now that we've had a tremendous amount of continued success, even prior to, was it 4 years ago, we had 5 first round picks. These are now adults that have their own children. I know, and it's funny that I used to give pucks through the camera glass, you know, to cute little children.
Yeah.
Now they're adults with their own children. It's the gift that just keeps on giving. Wow. And now through that success of a lot of players that have come from Missouri, they give back too because they have children. And now when you start spreading the tentacles and the wealth of knowledge, as far as coaches go, you're touching way more players. And when you touch more players, not only probability increases for success, but before that is the competition, not only for the players on the ice, but coaches to get better. So to sit around and have hockey talk is way more important than getting your information off the internet. And that's what happens. You see a lot of guys, you know, kicking around. I mean, a conversation might start about remember the day or back in the day, you remember then, but realistically it'll get down to, help me out with this situation. You've had experience. How does that work? Well, it's all on the coaching. It's all about giving back.
It's frustrating to have players from Illinois. I was kidding when I sent you the email on the invite, but we spent a lot of windshield time on the way back from St. Louis on a weekend 0-5. So understand yeah. completely on that one, whether it was Afton or Chesterfield or who that may have been. But that's, I guess that's the ultimate compliment in that regard for us from Illinois to have to tip our cap on that one. So, hey, Rick, you've been just amazing with your time. Appreciate your sharing and all. And as part of our tradition here, John gets the last question. So I'm going to turn it over to John for a wrap up. Because I got to give it to the Hall of Famer to ask the Hall of Famer.
Hey, Rick, I want to ask you a quick, not a long answer. Any aspirations before I go into my final here? Any aspirations of coaching in the NHL?
There always is. It is.
I want you to know if you can help an 0-6 Blackhawk team right now.
It was. I'd love to. I mean, it is. A lot of these guys that have positions in the general manager's positions and also head coaches, I have relationships with strictly through friendship. My latest conversation was actually with Gerard Gallant in New York. When he got the job in Vegas, I was looking to get a position in Vegas. He had his normal 2 head coaches. George McPhee was hiring the 3rd. It's just being in the right place at the right time. Understand that there's a laundry list of resumes. You have to be seen, you have to be current. As a coach working your way up, what happens if you spend too long at a level, you get pigeoned as only good enough at that level. So it becomes somewhat contrasting. This will be my 14th year at Lindenwood. The perception because college hockey is only played on the weekend doesn't translate to the pro game is another prejudice that happens. So there's an awful lot of restrictions. Citizenship won't be said, but that has an awful lot as far as influence goes. So yes, I would love to. It is thankless hours in the rink as far as assistant coaches go. They have videos and meetings for more videos and meetings. It is before the trainers show up, assistant coaches are there, and they're there all night. So you might as well say that you're married to the program and kiss your wife and family goodbye. It takes a special wife and family to accept.
Understand
that.
All this. Yes. Well, listen, I have to tell you, because I know Mark's got to get going himself. This was truly, thank you so much. I mean, we could talk about this Lindenwood. We even didn't talk to hit the cornerstone on this Lindenwood thing. I have to tell you a funny story before I go. And I know my partner, Mark, this is Eric, tonight appreciated this because Mark was a defenseman growing up and a great hockey player in my town, my partner. But I got to tell you, I'm coaching at the Northwest Chargers real quick. I had a Pee Wee Gold team and Mike had a Pee Wee Central States team, your brother. So I heard the name Zombo's going to be coaching Pee Wee Central States. Now, I didn't know your brother. So all of a sudden, I'm looking for you. And I go up to this guy who was your brother. And I says, hey, did you hear Rick Zombo is going to be coaching Pee Wee Central States? He goes, Rick Zombo? He goes, you mean Mike Zombo? He goes, well, who's Mike Zombo? I go, he goes, it's me. Takes a puck and fires one just inside my ear. Say hello for me.
That's funny stuff. I got news for you. I know that you're friends with Dick Sayad. And he was a close friend of my father's. And my father passed away 3 years ago. But I know the relationship. And also when I talked to my brother about you, anytime you want to talk hockey, I'm all over it.
You're coming back on Angles and Attitude. We love it's this. Fantastic.
I appreciate it. Thanks,
John. All right, thanks, Rick. Be well.
No problem, Mark.
Thank you. Adios.